Books on Tape presents The Electric Universe by David Bodanis, read by Del Roy. Mysterious Affair, Electricity, Samuel Beckett, Theater 2. Introduction. When my father was a little boy in a village in Poland before the First World War, an electricity blackout wouldn't have been especially important. There were no cars, which meant there were no traffic lights to fail, and there were no refrigerators, just blocks of ice or cool rooms, so food wouldn't suddenly spoil either. A very few rich people would find their electric lights failing if the generator stopped working in their homes, and the single telegraph line that passed through the town might stop operating, but by and large, daily life would continue as it had before. By the time my father's family had migrated to Canada and then to Chicago in the early 1920s, a big power outage would have been different. People would still have been able to buy things. There were no credit cards that depended on computer verification, but the streetcars that workers rode to the factories wouldn't run. The telephones that offices depended on wouldn't work either. And the skyscrapers that the city was so proud of would quickly have become inaccessible. Or at least their upper floors would have, as their elevators failed too. It still wouldn't have been a complete catastrophe. Farm crops could still be raised, there weren't many tractors, and coal-fired trains and steam-driven ships would have kept the city pretty well supplied. Today, though, I live in London now, where people can be pretty phlegmatic. But I still wouldn't want to be around for a complete blackout. Most radios and TVs plug in these days, so it would be difficult to find out whether your kid's school was still open. Your cell phones might still operate, but with no way of recharging your battery, you'd be pretty careful about using it. Driving the kids to school on the off chance it was open would be too much of a gamble, for gas stations depend on underground storage tanks. And until the blackout ended, stations wouldn't be able to use their electrically operated pumps to bring up more fuel to sell to anyone in the city. You couldn't stock up on groceries, no credit cards working, nor could you get more cash, for ATMs depend on electrically run computers too. Within a week, the city would really have broken down. Police stations would be isolated with their phones not working, and pretty soon their radio batteries would lose their charge as well. No one could call ambulances, for their radios or phone links would be out too. A few people might try walking to hospitals, but there wouldn't be much there. No x-rays, no refrigerated vaccines, no refrigerated blood, no ventilation, no lighting. Going to the airport to try to escape wouldn't help, for with backup generators not working, the airport's radars would have shut down. Nor could planes take off on manual control, for any fuel that remained in underground tanks couldn't be pumped up. As the blackout spread, the nation's ports would have closed, with no electricity to run the cranes that moved their large containers, and no way to check electronic inventories. The military might try to guard fuel convoys, but with their own vehicles running low on fuel, that wouldn't last long. If the blackout was worldwide, isolation would intensify. The internet and all email would have gone down very quickly. Next, the phone lines. Finally, the last television and radio broadcasts would end. Starvation would probably begin in the dense cities of Asia, especially with no air conditioning at food warehouses. Within a few weeks of a complete blackout, almost all the world's cities and suburbs would be unlivable. There would be fighting, pretty desperate for food and fuel, and with a world population of 6 billion, few people would have a chance of surviving. But what if it were not only our supply of electricity that failed? What if the very existence of electrical forces stopped? All the Earth's oceans would gush upward and evaporate as the electrical bond between water molecules broke apart. DNA strands within our body would no longer hold together. Any air-breathing organism that was still intact would begin to suffocate. For without electrical attraction, the oxygen molecules in air would bounce uselessly off the hemoglobin molecules in blood. The ground itself would open up and begin to melt as the electrical forces that hold the silicates and other substances of our planet together let go. Mountains would collapse into the voids left where the continental plates had torn apart. In the last moments, a few living beings would see the sun itself switch off, as our star's electrically carried light abruptly stopped and the world's very last day turned to night. Why doesn't any of this happen? The force of electricity is very powerful and has been operating nonstop for more than 13 billion years. But it's also utterly hidden, crammed deep within all rocks and stars and atoms. The force is like two Olympian arm wrestlers whose struggle is unnoticed because their straining hands barely move. There are almost always equal amounts of positive and negative electric charge within everything around us, so well balanced that although their effects are everywhere, their existence remains unseen. For long eons, it remained like this, as galaxies evolved and planets formed, as continents and trees and grasses appeared on Earth. Occasionally, there must have been brief sightings in the past. Our Australopithecine ancestors would have noticed abrupt bursts of lightning, as would early humans. But as soon as it appeared, this force would quickly have returned to the invisible realm from which it had come. For most of history, humans simply stumbled around it unaware. In one of his writings, Isaac Bashevis Singer imagines a peasant in medieval Ireland who takes off his flaxen tunic one night and notices bright sparks leaping from the fabric. If Singer's peasant called in the village priest and other wise elders to see it happen the next night, they would be unlikely to notice anything. Static electric sparks usually appear only in dry air, and Ireland is wet. No one would believe what he'd seen. No one would have been able to examine it further. Even in dry desert countries, dust or sand could make scattered sparks seem to appear and disappear in purely random ways. There were many fragmentary efforts to penetrate this hidden world from classical Greek times on, but even into the mid-1700s, there was little true knowledge. The breakthrough came with the work of a conveniently vain Italian investigator, Alessandro Volta, in the 1790s. It would be a great honor, he felt, to locate the portal from which this mysterious electricity emerged. And, after much effort, he realized where he should search. He found that if he pressed a coin-shaped copper disc against one side of his tongue and a zinc disc against the other, and then touched the tips of the two coins together, a tingling sensation would race across his tongue. He'd located the world's first steadily operating battery in his mouth. Volta soon found that any two metals would do the trick, so long as they were separated by a small amount of saliva, brine, or other corrosive liquid. He didn't know why this worked, or how the brine was making extra electrons appear on one of the metals. But he could send the tingling spray of electrons along a laboratory bench through a wire and was getting famous just for describing it, and that was enough. The stuff that came out of this battery rushed forward like water in a river, so it was called an electric current. As the Victorian era dawned, that was still most of our knowledge. Two metals, when positioned near each other, could sometimes produce a sparking current within a wire connecting them. It seemed a weak, merely curious phenomenon, but it was the first useful door into a world that had been sealed and hidden. In this book, I show what has happened in the 2 centuries since humankind opened that door, which took a mere 2 centuries. The first part looks at the Victorian researchers who had only a few tenuous glimpses of electricity, yet created devices never before imagined. There were telephones and telegraphs and light bulbs, roller coasters and fast streetcars, and ever more electric motors powering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.